25.
Yeah. So now that we have talked about the human values from module 1 to module 4, right, on the basis of right understanding and the right feeling, we are now talking about how these values will express in our living with the world outside. How will it express in terms of our behavior, in terms of our work, in terms of our participation? So this is basically the, you know, content of this module 4, module 5. So in module 5, first we try to kind of recollect, you know, or put things together as to how these human values, you know, naturally follow on the basis of our right understanding, on the basis of our understanding of coexistence, harmony, and relationship. And then based on these values, how our thoughts are guided, and how these values get expressed in terms of our conduct. So in lecture 23, we talked about the implication of right understanding, which is basically in terms of a natural, you know, feelings that we have in ourselves on the basis of this right understanding, which are called as human values. And then with these human values, in lecture 25, we talked about how it reflects, you know, how these values reflect in terms of the human conduct. So how these thoughts are guided by these values, and how these values reflect in terms of our behavior, in terms of our work, in terms of our participation in the larger order. So we can see that this right understanding and this clarity about the values, you know, the human values, the universal human values, can then guide our human conduct. And we can also see that in the light of this clarity about the human values and about the human conduct, we can now talk about professional ethics with lot of clarity, We can also see that unless we have clarity about, you know, this basic existential law of coexistence, harmony, and relationship, and unless we have these values set in place, and unless, you know, this right understanding and these human values have become the base for our human conduct, we cannot really understand what is going to be the professional ethics. And even if we can conceive in terms of thoughts, right, we will not be able to work it out. We will not be able to follow it. So what we will see in this lecture is that in the light of right understanding and in the light of these basic human values, which naturally follow out of this right understanding, we will have this human conduct. And when this human conduct is there in us, it will reflect itself in every profession that we do. It will reflect itself in every profession we do. And then we will see, you know, that yes, this profession that we are doing, you know, we'll do it in an ethical manner. So this right understanding and this values provide the basis for the ethics, for the professional ethics. So this is what we will see. And in the light of this right understanding in human values, we can now work out, you know, how this professional ethics would look like, what will be the basic principles and what will be the basic guidelines. And we will also see that this ethics will naturally follow if we have the right understanding of coexistence, harmony, and relationship. If we have these basic human values of, you know, trust, to love, you know, and compassion, then things will naturally follow. You know, this professional ethics will naturally follow. So in the previous lecture, so let's look at that. In the previous lecture, we saw that how right understanding provides the basis for ethical human conduct. Now in this lecture, we shall try to understand that it is this ethical competence only which is instrumental in ensuring professional ethics as well. So this right understanding leads to human values, which leads to human conduct, which provides the basis for the basic principles and guidelines for our performance in any profession that we are engaged in. So let's look at that. So let us define this profession in the context of what we have been talking about, the humane society, you know, what we have been talking about, the human order, the universal human order. So the profession is defined in the context of this humane society that we have been talking about, which essentially means, you know, it is defined in the context of the comprehensive human goal. So we have defined right from the first lecture in this foundation course on universal human values. In the very first lecture, we have defined what is the comprehensive human goal at the individual level and at the collective level. So at the level of individual and at the level of society, what is the human goal? That we have defined right from the beginning. So we said at the individual level, what we desire for is the continuity of happiness, which includes prosperity as well. And at the level of society, at the level of collectivity, that we desire for, you know, continuous happiness, of course, then prosperity, you know, then trust, and ultimately the mutual fulfillment, the coexistence. And when we are saying continuous happiness in this human being or individual, it would certainly include the health. So we, you know, as a collectivity, we desire for happiness in the self, health in the body, prosperity in the family, trust and fearlessness in the society, and mutual fulfillment with the, you know, entire nature, coexistence with the entire nature. So this is our comprehensive human goal, both at the individual level and at the societal level. And we can define profession in the light of this, you know, comprehensive human goal, in the light of this humane society that we have been talking about. So a profession is a mode of participation by human beings in the larger order in pursuance of comprehensive human goal, both individual and collective. So we have this behavior, work, and participation in the larger order, which we have defined as human conduct. And if you look at this participation in the larger order, there can be many ways of this participation. And one of this is what we are calling as profession. So a profession basically is a mode of participation by the human being in the larger order in pursuance of comprehensive human goal. So we are participating in this human society, in this human order, right? And one of the mode could be a profession. A profession in this sense that if you look at this human society, it has different systems, different dimensions of ensuring the fulfillment of this human goal. So when I'm participating in one of these systems, one of these dimensions of the human society, it is called a profession. So I understand it, that participation, I believe in it, understand and I accept, and therefore I take the responsibility and I participate. That is a profession. So if I understand that if prosperity has to be ensured in the society, in the family, then we have to produce. So I identify one of the profession, one of the production process which I can participate in. So when I'm participating in that production process, that participation is what is called a profession. And when you look at this profession, there are two important things. Number one is that I have this comprehensive human goal in the at the back of my mind, that is my purpose, both at the individual level and at the collective level. And to ensure the fulfillment of this goal, human goal, I am participating in one of the dimensions of the society. So production process is one dimension by which prosperity is ensured. So one of the human goal of prosperity is ensured by way of my participation in the production process. So that is one of the system in the human society which will ensure the fulfillment of the human goal of prosperity. So that is a profession. Similarly, when I am teaching, I am participating in this dimension of human education, whereby ensure right understanding, right feeling in every child, which in turn will ensure continuity of happiness. So when I'm trying to fulfill this human goal of continuous happiness, both at the individual level and at the collective level, right, by way of participating in this education system, human education system, then it is a profession. So this is the way the profession is defined, if I understand this whole existential order and I understand myself in this existential order. And then I can understand the human society and the human goal and my participation in it. So basically profession is one way of participating in the larger order to ensure the fulfillment of human goal. Now, the excellence or the process, success of any profession activity is to be judged from this comprehensive point of view only and not in terms of merely wealth generation. So this is what we have to understand, that if we can understand this human society and the human goal, and if we are defining this profession in the light of this participation in this human society, in this larger order, then we can see that whether a profession is being done properly or not, whether it is successful, whether it has reached to the excellence or not, will be judged or evaluated on the basis of fulfillment of this comprehensive human goal. And not just the wealth generation, not just the accumulation of physical facility. This is important that we have to keep in mind. And if you remember, right, in the first lecture, we said that if we are only working for physical facility, that would not suffice for human being. It may suffice for animals, but not for human beings. So as long as we are living with animal consciousness, our ultimate purpose could be this, accumulation of more and more, wealth or physical facility. But when we look at it from the human, perspective, from human consciousness, then we see that, yes, physical facility is important, but relationship is more important than that. And ultimately, the right understanding is most important. So the excellence or the success of any profession would be evaluated on the basis of this comprehensive human goal, whether this goal has been reached or whether this profession has been successful in ensuring one of the comprehensive human goal or the human goal as such, then only it is successful, otherwise it is not successful. The profession is not only a means of earning one's livelihood, but also a means of one's evolution by appropriate participation in the larger order. So this is important, that when I'm participating in this profession, it is not just accumulation, just giving me the livelihood. But it is also helping me as self to evolve to higher and higher level of consciousness. So this is very important. This is very important, that when I'm participating in a profession, I'm of course, ensuring my livelihood, but this is not all that there is, right? So I'm ensuring my livelihood, that physical facility is a part of it, but more than that, it is helping me to evolve myself, right? From animal consciousness to human consciousness. That is important. The self-evolution is important. And if I am evolving myself, and if I am participating with this clarity, then whatever I am understanding and whatever feeling I am having, I am authenticating that. So it is an important activity to authenticate my understanding, whereby we interact with other human beings and with rest of nature in a mutually fulfilling manner. So this is important. You can see that if I am able to understand and I'm able to ensure this right feeling in me myself, which is basically the evolution of the self, then it will reflect in terms of my participation in this profession, right? My participation with human being, with rest of nature, in a mutually fulfilling manner. So this is important. So this profession that I'm engaged in is not just, helping me to earn my livelihood, but it is helping me to evolve myself and also express myself. So evolve myself at the level of my consciousness, and express myself at the level of my participation with the world outside, in terms of my behavior, in terms of my work, in terms of my participation in the larger order. So profession is for ensuring the evolution of this self and expression of this self, right, with the world outside. Right? That is what we are calling as authentication. And this is authenticated by way of participating with human being and with rest of nature in a mutually fulfilling manner. So this is how we would see the profession, in the light of our right understanding and in the light of our participation in the human society. Yes. So this professional ethics can be seen as the code of ethical conduct of this profession, as we have described above. And the ethical conduct of profession implies the right utilization of one's professional ethics for participation in the larger order towards the fulfillment of comprehensive human goal. So this is how we can define professional ethics. So number one, we are saying this professional ethics can be defined as the code of ethical conduct of the profession, right? And this ethical conduct of profession implies the right utilization of one's professional skills for participation in the larger order towards the fulfillment of comprehensive human goal. So if I have acquired certain skills for a particular profession, then this professional ethics would essentially mean the code of conduct by which I can ensure the right utilization of my professional skills, right, for participation in the larger order, okay, in the area which we have already, you know, taken the, you know, training and we have developed the skills. So utilizing that professional skill to participate in that particular system, right, so that we can participate in the larger order, ensuring the fulfillment of one or many of these comprehensive human goals. So this is how we can define professional ethics. So if I'm trained in, let's say, production of certain particular kind of thing, so I will use this skill, this professional skill, in a manner that it helps in participating meaningfully in that particular profession, in that particular production, so that the goal of prosperity, the human goal of prosperity, can be met out. So if I have this skill of, you know, engineering or management or any such skill, I can participate in the process of production system in a manner that it helps in ensuring the fulfillment of human goal of prosperity. Prosperity for human being and preservation of rest of nature. So that will be my, you know, basic guideline for the professional ethics. Yes. So we can reflect on this definition of professional ethics. See whether it is making sense to us or it is not making sense to us. So if we define this professional ethics in this manner, then some of these, you know, important points that we can notice about this professional ethics, right, some of the salient features would be the following. Number one, we'll have this clarity about the human goal, both at the individual level and at the collective level. So this is one thing. Second, when we have this clarity in oneself, you know, about the human goal, it will have, and you know, we have the clarity about the human goal and how it can be fulfilled through the, you know, human society, through these different dimensions, different systems of human society. So when we have that clarity, then we'll have confidence in oneself, as well as confidence in the harmony, the coexistence and self-regulation prevailing in the entire existence. So this is very important, that when I understand, when I have this right understanding about the existential order, right, and we can see and, you know, understand the human being and the participation of human being in this existential order, right, we are, have clarity about this human society and about this human goal and how it can be fulfilled in the human society. Then these two things, you know, one is that I have this confidence in myself that yes, whatever is, you know, the human goal can be fulfilled and will be fulfilled through this process of human society. So that is one confidence that I have in myself. And I also have this, you know, confidence in this existential harmony, right? In this coexistence, in this self-regulation, right? Which is already there in this entire existence. And not that I have to make that, you know, or create that. It is already there. I only have to understand it. So this is very important, you know, confidence in oneself and confidence in this entire existence, in this entire existential order, the existential harmony, coexistence. So this confidence is important, you know, and it is based on the understanding of the existential order and the human being and the role of human being in this existential order, which gives clarity about the human goal as well as the human society. Now, when we have this clarity and this confidence, then it leads to my competence, right? I am able to develop this competence for ensuring mutually fulfilling behavior. And I am also able to develop this competence of mutually enriching interaction with the rest of nature. So this is important, that if I have the clarity and confidence about the existential order and my participation in it, then it results into my competence, my desire, thought, and expectations, you know, working along the line of this participation. I have developed this competence of mutually enriching behavior, mutually fulfilling behavior with human being, and mutually enriching interaction with rest of nature. And when we have this, you know, clarity and confidence and that competence, right? Now we can see that we'll have a holistic vision about, you know, the production system, about the technologies, about the management techniques, right? So this is very important, that with this clarity and confidence about the existential harmony and our participation in it, right? And with this competence to work in a mutually fulfilling manner with human being and with rest of nature, now we can think in terms of developing production systems, the technologies and the management techniques, which are in line with this coexistence, harmony, and relationship. So we have a holistic vision about the production process, about the technologies, about the management techniques, right? And we do not see these things in a very, you know, kind of narrow manner, you know, as we are doing today. So with this, ultimately, I understand my, you know, social responsibility, my societal responsibility, you know, what I have to do in the society and how I have to do it. So that understanding, that clarity and confidence about my social responsibility and how I can fulfill it, that is what it results into. So this is, you know, the kind of salient features of this professional ethics, that if I'm working with this professional ethics, the way we have defined, then this is what we will have, you know, in each of the, you know, human being, in ourselves. Yes. So let's look at this, you know, and kind of try to reflect, you know, and see whether it is making sense or not. So we will investigate into this, explore into this, you know, the definition that we have given about professional ethics, about the profession and so on. So we'll see if there are questions we'll take up, you know, just at the end of the talk. But now, if we have clarity about this professional ethics, you know, in the light of right understanding, in the light of, you know, the human values, then now we can get back and see, you know, what is the current scenario, what is the situation, you know, how this professional ethics is defined in the world today, right? And what are the, you know, kind of outcome of that definition of professional ethics, right? So what is the status of this, you know, professional ethics, and what are the issues involved in professional ethics in the current time? So if you look at this, we can see that issues in professional ethics are becoming very complex in the current scenario, right? It is very complex in the sense that we are facing many problems in the profession, right? At the individual level and at the societal level, right? And they are becoming complex in the sense that we do not know what to do with it. So that is how they are becoming very complex. The unethical practices are rapidly increasing, and their impact is also becoming far-reaching. So that we can see, you know, now so much of media and social media and all that, you know, we know how things are going on, right? How things are going on. So we have this epidemic of unethical practices. We are frequently coming across serious scams, major economic offenses, kickbacks in large-scale purchases, etc., right? So we know all the details about it. Most of you would know, you know, what is happening. So every day something like that comes in. So scams, like, you know, involving few lakhs, crores of, you know, money. Okay. And that too done by the top, you know, so-called top people in the management or in the government, right? So that is what is happening. And we don't know what to do with it. We don't know what to do with it. So yesterday also we had one such, you know, scam coming in media. So one state, you know, one unethical practice involving something like 200 crores worth of, you know, money every day, and something like 50,000 plus people are involved in the process. So it is quite well distributed also. So what we see around today is corruption in multiple forms and at various levels. So these are some of the lists, you know, the tax invasion, misappropriation and misuse of public funds, misuse of political power and bureaucratic authority, bureaucratic authority, right? Misleading propaganda, unethical advertisements, and sales promotion. I mean, you know all this, okay? But I'm just naming them. Cutthroat competition, exploiting the weaknesses of consumers through various, you know, enticement, bewildering advertisements. You see so many advertisements now, you know. In fact, social media is one interesting thing, you know. They will kind of, their headings are quite misleading. So even small, small things, you know, that's where we have gone. Exploiting the weakness of consumers through various enticement, bewildering advertisements, and so on. Adulteration, of course, and spurious production. Endangering the health and safety of public at large, right? Hoarding and overcharging. So this is some of the list, and this list could be much longer. Right? So I don't have to name them all. Many of you, you know all these things. Now this is the problem we are facing, right? And we do not know what to do. But we are trying to do something. Whether it is really working out or not, we are trying to do something. Okay. And what we are trying to do is this. So this is the list of what we are trying to do. And then we will see whether it works or it does not. So this promoting awareness about professional ethics by introducing new courses, refresher programs, and case studies. So this is being done, you know, in different professions, in medical and management and so on. So we think that we will introduce some course on professional ethics where we will inform people that so much of, you know, ill practices are taking place, and you know, we have to, you know, take care of it. We have to fight against it and so on. Administering oath and prescribing codes of ethical conduct for a specific professional discipline. So this is interesting, you know. So you will, you know, draft some oaths, okay, and you will prescribe some code of ethical conduct for a specific professional discipline. And then everybody who is going into that discipline has to take that oath and is expected to go by those prescribed codes. Right. But most of the time it does not work. Most of the time it does not work. Okay. And when you see people taking oaths and accepting that, yes, we will go by this ethical conduct and not going by it, you feel so frustrated. You feel frustrated if you are not able to do it. You feel frustrated if people are not able to do it. And that is why you have so much of reaction. So what Sivadasanji was telling that day, you know, that when he thinks of values, he is very comfortable and he, you know, feels comfortable to teach that. But when it comes to ethics, he is quite disturbed. You know, lot of, you know, feeling of opposition. That feeling of opposition is coming from this fact that we are taking oath and we are not able to be with it. Right? We accept that we will go by these professional codes, you know, but we are not able to do that. We are not able to do it. Others are not able to do it. So while you are prescribing it, while you are teaching it, you know that it is not going to work. So that is the crisis. Setting up mechanisms for intensive audit, inspection, and monitoring the activity. Right. This is something which we do. Framing more stringent laws and, you know, devising harder punishment for offenses, promoting transparency in working systems through mechanisms like RTI. So if there is corruption and, you know, if there are rules which are violated, this audit people who go to audit, they themselves get corrupt. So if all this is happening, then you say that no, you must have very stringent laws, you know, and you must give very hard punishment so that people don't dare to do it, right? But it doesn't work. And then you say that, okay, if such thing is happening, you know, let people have the right to get this information, you know, as to what is happening in the system. So when they know it, they can, you know, kind of stop it or at least register it. So we have laws of right to information, for example, RTI. But the problem is that these RTI people themselves, you know, they make it a profession and start taking bribe for, you know, not asking these questions in RTI. So you know all that. Then you have this carrying out sting operations and widely publishing serious lapses in ethical conduct of profession through media. So this one I was talking about, 200 crores now per day, is now is flashed in the media. Right. That 4G scam was flashed in media. You know. But what happens out of it, that we all know. Then we have this encouraging whistleblowing by individuals or groups. So this whistleblowing basically is, you know, kind of bringing to the attention of the people that this is what is happening, you know, and we must do something about it. But then again, you can see that, you know, people who are doing it, if they do not have this right understanding and these human values at the base, they are not able to maintain themselves. And they themselves are likely to get influenced by this corruption. Setting up Lokpals, you know what is happening, yes. Vigilance commissions, ethics committees, tribunals, consumer protection forums, and so on. So this all you know. And if all this does not work, filing this PIL, public interest litigations. So these are the things which are done, you know, to take care of the problem that we are facing today. But it does not seem to work. So this inefficacy of prevailing approach is that looking at various methods and mechanisms which are being presently employed to check these trends and their effectiveness, one can see that most of the methods being adopted are either of symptomatic nature or punitive measures or crisis management techniques rather than the real solution to the whole problem. So this is the problem, you know, that what we are trying to do with these problems, this unethical conduct, is that either we are trying to treat some symptom of it, right? So some symptom is treated, the whole problem is not taken care of. Or we are trying to stop things through punitive measures, right? So giving punishment. But the outcome of this is that if this person does not have this understanding and these values, he will try to find out the ways, you know, to escape from your punishment. And that is what is happening. And at the most, you are trying to do the crisis management. That if there is so much of correction and there is so much of problem, how do you manage, right? How do you manage? So crisis management is, you know, what is there. So all this is not solving the problem in the real sense. So we don't have this real solution to the whole problem, you know, in a holistic manner. We are trying to treat them as symptoms, or we are trying to do the crisis management, or if we are not able to stop it, we are, you know, trying to work out, you know, punishments. But all this put together is not able to solve the problem in the real sense. So the focus in these methods is primarily towards curbing the ill effects rather than rectifying the root cause, namely the faulty worldview, right? So the very world vision has gone wrong, which we have been talking about right from the first day, right? Which continues to remain dominant, right? And that is managing the disease rather than ensuring health. So today what we are trying to do is we are trying to manage the disease and not taking care of the health. Right. Am I audible, Rajulji?
Rajulji? Oh, yes, Ganeshji, you are very much audible.
Yeah, showing some disconnected. Okay. So what we are saying is that we are not able to see things in a holistic manner. And when we are not able to see things in a holistic manner, we are not able to see a holistic, you know, solution to the problem. Right? So this holistic vision of life is missing. The holistic vision of the world, the existence, the nature is missing. Therefore, we are not able to understand this world. We are not able to understand ourselves, and we are not able to understand our participation in this world, in this existence, right? And we are taking things in a very partisan manner, and we are trying to work with them, and it does not work. So the basic problem is that, right? We have a faulty world vision, right? And on the basis of that, we are trying to work out things and it does not work. We repair at one place and there are 100 leakage in some other place. So that is the problem of professional ethics today. So if you look at this state of things today, and particularly in the profession and the professional ethics, right, there are certain inherent contradictions and dilemmas, right? And we can see how we can resolve this if we have a holistic vision of life, right? If you have a worldview or world vision which is holistic in nature, and that is what we are talking about. So let's look at that. We can understand more clearly through examples how the contradictions and dilemmas are inherently generated by the prevailing worldview in which wealth maximization is perceived to be the prime objective. So we have seen right in the first session, lecture one, that if we are trying to go with physical facility alone, right, this will suffice for animals, but it will not suffice for human being. Because for human being, physical facility is important, but relationship is more important than physical facility. And right understanding in the self is most important. And therefore we said that if you want to ensure the fulfillment of human goal at the individual level and the collective level, then we have to work for right understanding. Right? We have to work for fulfillment in relationship through values. And then we have to work for physical facility in the light of first two. So the problem today is that if we are working only for physical facility, if we are working only for wealth generation, then in the process, we ourselves are creating many contradictions. Right? We are creating many contradictions and many dilemmas. So this prevailing worldview in which wealth maximization or accumulation of physical facility has become the ultimate goal, right? We are creating these contradictions. We are creating these dilemmas. And we can see that in this kind of worldview, in this kind of world vision, the other person's happiness, which is assumed to be related to the wealth accumulation, seems to be in conflict with my happiness. So if my happiness is defined by way of accumulation of more and more physical, you know, things, then if I'm accumulating, I'm certainly denying the other. So my happiness is in contradiction with others' happiness, is in conflict with the other's happiness. If that is the case, then the other people have to be exploited for one to gain affluence, right? One to accumulate. And there is no possibility of mutual fulfillment in a sustainable manner. So if my happiness depends upon my accumulation of physical facility, then I have to exploit you, right? I have to exploit the other, because if I have to accumulate, right, somebody else will be denied. So the very process of ensuring fulfillment of this basic desire of happiness, which is now related to physical facility, you know, to profit maximization, goes in opposition to the happiness of the other. So I end up exploiting others, right, to accumulate more and more. So in the same way, exploitation of nature also becomes inevitable, as it helps a person to accumulate wealth easily, and there is no limit to this. So if I want to accumulate more and more, right, I have to exploit other people, and I also have to exploit nature, because ultimately the resources are coming from nature. And if I want to go on accumulating and go on consuming more and more, I have to exploit the rest of nature also. So that is what is happening. You can see all around. So if you take the example for, you know, of a business, how we go about, can we mutually fulfilling for other human beings in this society? Or are we mutually fulfilling for them in a sustainable manner? So take the example of business circles where wherever there is a scarcity of commodity due to, say, monsoon failure or other natural disturbances or wars, etc. The people in general are in distress and need support. Very simple, right? However, in such a situation, what do we do? What do these businessmen do? So if these businessmen are, you know, having this prevailing inhuman worldview, do they think in terms of providing support to the people? Or they feel elated and look at it as an opportunity to make maximum profit? So if my worldview is to get happiness through maximization of my wealth or maximization of my profit, then I will look for such opportunity. Right? So rather than being fulfilling for the other, right, I would prefer to create crisis in the other, right? Deprive the other and use that as an opportunity to maximize my profit, maximize my gain of physical things. So this is what is happening. This is what is happening today. And you can't solve these problems by, you know, taking oath. So if you look at both, you know, what is being proposed here as professional ethics or ethics, and what is, you know, being done in the world today, we can make a comparative study of the two. Right? So we have just listed down these different approaches to ethics and professional ethics. Right? The second column is talking about how it is perceived in the prevalent time, right? And what is the perspective of this prevalent time, the current time, and what is being proposed. You know? So what is proposed is, you know, we are saying it is a human way of going about. So in a human way, how it would look like, and what we are doing today, you know, this is the comparison between the two. So different approaches to ethics and professional ethics. So if you look at the basis of professional ethics, today if you look at the basis is some assumptions, some thoughts, right? About what is ethics, what is professional ethics, what is human being, what is his existence, nature, and all that. What we are proposing is that the basis of ethics and professional ethics has to be right understanding of coexistence, harmony, and relationship. So we have to understand the coexistence, the harmony, the relationship, which is there in existence, which is there in nature. This is the way every unit in nature is. It is in coexistence, harmony, and relationship. This we have to understand. This only can be the basis of ethics and professional ethics. Anything short of it will not work. Now, if you look at the feeling that we have today, right, the basic feeling we have is the feeling of opposition. In what we are proposing, right from the beginning, we are saying what is naturally acceptable to us is the feeling of relationship. Feeling of relationship with other human beings, feeling of relationship with every unit in nature. Now, when we have this feeling of opposition, right, then the values that we have, or that we assume, they are based on these assumptions and this feeling of opposition. So you think in terms of, competition, you think in terms of, cutthroat competition, you think in terms of riding over the other, all these are supposed to be the basic things, values that with which you go. I mean, whether you call them values or not is another thing, but this is what you are pursuing. Right? This is what you are pursuing. So most of what we consider is valuable is based on this feeling of opposition. Right. What we are proposing is that when we have this understanding of right understanding of coexistence, harmony, and relationship, and we have this feeling of relationship, then we will have these values which are naturally acceptable to us. Right? This feeling of trust, respect, ultimately the love and compassion. So these are going to be the values that we have been talking about all through. And ultimately, we will work for the well-being of all. Not only for mutual fulfillment, but for well-being of all. So that is going to be our value. Now, with this, we can see how ethics would look like, right? So ethics basically means how to interact with the world outside. So when, if you look at what is prevalent today, mostly, we are prescribing certain things. When we see problems, we prescribe certain things in terms of oath, in terms of certain codes, right, that we have just talked about. And we can see that when we are doing it, most of the time we are ourselves not very confident about it, right? And we find that it is not working. What we are proposing that if we understand this coexistence, harmony and relationship, if we have these feelings of opposite, of relationship, if we have understood these values, right, and if we are owning these values by way of our own right understanding, then the details based on this right understanding of harmony, coexistence, and relationship, and which can be verified by everyone through their natural acceptance, okay, then there is basic agreement for order in the society. There is basic agreement for order, for harmony in the society. And that willingness is there to work for ensuring this harmony in the society. So there is basic agreement for participation in this human society. Right? And this is verifiable by each one of us through our own natural acceptance. So this is not something which is given as a prescription, right, and which is supported, through reward and punishment, but it is something which is coming out of my own natural acceptance, out of my own understanding, out of my own feeling. So this, how to interact with the world, that is in a mutually fulfilling manner, okay, that we have described, that comes naturally. We have a natural acceptance for this, and each one of us can verify this for ourselves. Then we will do this in a very natural manner, and we would not need enforcement from outside. So if you look at the way of ensuring this in the society, right? What is done today is, you know, you are given this training about professional ethics. Okay. You define certain discipline, and you also have these incentives and punishment, right, for following these codes, you know, or not following it. So you are given training, you are given this, you know, you work out certain disciplines, right, which people have to follow while doing that profession. And if they are not following, okay, you try either in terms of giving some incentive or giving some punishment. So if they are, you give incentive so that they can do it. And if they are not doing it, you give some punishment. But all this is not working. What we are proposing is that if we have this clarity about, you know, coexistence, harmony in relationship, and we have this feeling of relationship, and we have these values, and things will naturally follow in our conduct. And for that, what we need is to provide human education to every child who is going through this process of, you know, learning and understanding. We have to provide this human education. Through human education, we have to ensure, you know, that they have this self-discipline, right? And through this self-discipline, okay, they will have this, you know, conduct in a very natural manner. Right? In a very natural manner. So this is a, you know, kind of comparative study about the different approaches to ethics and professional ethics. The approach that is being, that is, you know, taken today, and the approach which is being proposed. Now it is for all of us to look into all this and, you know, evaluate for ourselves, explore and evaluate, okay, what makes the sense, what is going on or what is proposed. So I think with this, I can just sum up that the way ahead is to resolve the situation, make sincere effort towards building up the ethical competence of human beings in general and professionals in particular through proper value education and value-based education, right? So this is what we require. What we require is to develop that right understanding, the right feeling, the right thought, the right values, and through that, you know, right human conduct or ethical human conduct. That is how we can resolve the problem today. And in order to do that, you know, what we have been proposing time and again, we have to ensure this value education, the value-based education and value-based living. So this is what has to be ensured in education. Education which is given by the parents, education which is given in the schools and colleges, the formal education, and education that is given through the society. So everywhere this has to be ensured, you know, the value education has to be ensured, the value-based education has to be ensured, and value-based living has to be ensured. In one simple word, we'll say human education is to be ensured, or holistic human education has to be ensured. That is how we can solve the problem ultimately. So what we have been saying right from the beginning, that transformation from animal consciousness to human consciousness through education is required. And transformation from inhuman society to human society is required through a proper human system, human order. That is how we can solve the problem. And this can be an effective way to safeguard professional ethics. So this professional ethics will automatically follow if we are able to do what we have just suggested in, that if we are able to ensure this value education, value-based education, value-based living, if we are able to ensure this holistic human education, then people will have ethical human conduct. And therefore, the professional ethics will be safeguarded. Yes. Next, Rajulji, can be. So in essence, what we have been saying is that a clarity about the human society, about the comprehensive human goal, right? The systems to ensure the fulfillment of this human goal, both at the level of individual and collective, right? And our participation in different dimensions of society will ensure ethics in profession. This also clarifies the lacuna in the present approach, right? Present approaches. So this is in essence what we have discussed, but as we said, this is a proposal for all of you to explore, investigate, right, and find out, okay, whether it is a right proposal or not, as far as this ethics and professional ethics goes.